force what they're recommending, but they are seeking to have war crimes against Benjamin Netanyahu and many in his cabinet for actions that they're taking against the Palestinians in Gaza.
In other words, it's all right for you.
It seems that reaction to this is what is judged in all their politics. In other words, whatever is brought against them, if their response is of greater magnitude, that is what is judged. Again, it's all figurative, but still, it shows the world that they oppose Israel, and they're not defending Israel. And Hamas, like you said, they perpetrated and broke the truce that was already in place. It wasn't as if they're looking at their time for a truce now, but on October 6th, there was a truce in place. Hamas broke the truce, and they're the ones that came in directly had planned, premeditated an attack against civilians.
It was planned for months.
2 years.
Yeah.
It was set back down. So you have a premeditated civilian attack against the population of Israel. Women raped, babies killed, babies beheaded, eyes poked out with bayonets, etc., and knives. And yet, the world has said very little about the damage that they have caused. And if you allow these individuals to continue on, they will come back and do it again. During this time of the last 7 months, today marks the 7 month anniversary, by the way, of the attack. They said they will do this again. So these colleges, these universities, and boy, is it causing mayhem in the world. And even a red carpet gala last night in New York. 1,000 of these protesters had to be stopped by the New York Police Department. Otherwise, they would invade that and prevent it. They're everywhere they go now. They're creating vandalism, damage. They're destroying monuments. They destroy it, but they definitely marred a World War I document or a monument last night in New York City. They're becoming more riotous and violent, and it needs to be quenched. Some other things I want to bring up, though, this wire, very important. Yesterday evening, the Israeli forces were able to create a limited incursion into the Rafah to gain operational control of the crossings there. Now, already Israel's being...
Is that its own town or city?
Yeah, Rafah is a very southern town in the Gaza Strip. The Gaza Strip is a little portion of land on the very southwest side of Israel that had been given over and Hamas voted in as the leading government there. But after this attack, Israel had come in through the north and they have now pushed all the Palestinians down into the south area of Rafah, which borders Egypt. Egypt has not opened up the crossing to allow the Palestinian people to escape the activity of war that might come. They did allow it to be opened up for the families of the Hamas leadership. Think of that. But in the meantime, Israel has now gone in with a limited incursion and has taken over operational control of the crossing. So this means humanitarian aid has the potential now to go into the Palestinian people. They did warn the Palestinians that they were going to be doing this, and it's still a resolve of Benjamin Netanyahu and Israel to continue to eliminate the last 4 battalions of Hamas fighters that are in the Rafah area. Secondly, yesterday, in another propaganda move by the Hamas, they publicly announced, and it's now all over the news, that they have okayed a ceasefire with Israel. However, it was a ceasefire that Israel did not approve. The terms were not agreed upon by Israel. So what they're trying to do is make Israel appear that they're unwilling to enter into a ceasefire by simply publicly announcing that we've agreed to terms, and now Israel is not. The reality is that the terms were never negotiated or agreed upon. It's just a political move. Also last night, 2 IDF soldiers, Israel Defense Forces soldiers, were killed by Hezbollah with a drone attack. So again, we're continuing to see attacks from the north through the Hezbollah organization. Which is also...
What will Israel do about these drones that come from that part of the world?
Sadly, by this way, many of these drones are very small. They're hard to detect, so they're able to create not large amounts of damage, but once again, I call it nuisance damage. But when you're dealing with the killing of individuals, it's more than just a nuisance. It now becomes a weapon of mass destruction. Israel typically responds by trying to attack the area where they believe the drones were launched, but as far as I know, there's been no retaliatory attack at this time, so it may be something more broad-based in the future they'll have to do. Now, fourth thing on the menu is this. Wall Street Journal reported this morning that the Biden administration is holding up the sale of what's called precision weapons to Israel. role of the Joint Direct Attack Munitions Guidance Kit. These JDAMs help bombs become very smart in precision attacks. Israel has been known to use great restraint in how they attack and the manner in which they attack. They use precision targeting to limit civilian or collateral damage in their attacks. By the Joe Biden administration, if the Wall Street Journal is correct in their reporting, is holding back these types of sophisticated weapons, that leaves Israel less strategic capability to target Hamas, and they'll have to use other tactics. It's almost as if, Brother Swagger, to me, this Biden administration is doing everything they can to help the Hamas, not only in their public discourse, but in their propaganda. But now, are they helping them by tying Israel's hands from using weapons that are more strategic for precision fighting and causing Israel to do something more broad-based, which would cause more civilian damage, once again bringing more criticism of the war against Israel for anything that they do against the Hamas because of the so-called civilian casualties that could occur?
Joe, they are withholding all ammunition and weapons?
It doesn't say. This particular cell, as I studied it from the Wall Street Journal, said that it was back in January, so it actually precedes the money that was just recently released for Israel. It was a $269 million sale, but apparently the Biden administration has not moved forward in supplying these 6,500, what we call JDAM. It's either a kit or a rocket system that can be used for strategic targeting of locations.
Israel can't put those things together themselves.
Sir, I don't know all of their capabilities. I know they have relied for many years on the U.S. assistance to supply them weapons, and most of these have been for defensive purposes. So possibly the Biden administration, in their efforts, constantly telling Israel, do not go into Rafah. For example, John Kirby yesterday, once again, made the statements publicly that we do not agree with Israel going into Rafah, although they claim we have, the U.S. has ironclad, what I'm looking for. They are strongly with Israel in regards to Israel's defense. But at the same time, Israel is defending herself by eliminating Hamas. It is not an offensive movement, what they're doing.
How many Hamas are left?
Four battalions of fighters are left, so the number is hard to estimate. A total, that's what they're assuming to be. So it might be, 5,000 to 6,000 people still fighters that are off the area.
Because they don't wear uniforms and you can't hardly tell who's what.
No, sir, they mix themselves in the civilian population. They look like the civilian population. They act like the civilian population. And they have their locations in civilian populations. So any attack against Hamas also has the opportunity for casualties to take place. Not only casualties of the Hamas, but the sad event of other civilians in the area. It was also reported, I'll bring this up, that the information coming from the Hamas, which is what everybody is relying on for the total number of casualties, they're claiming over 34,500 have been killed by Israel. But the reality is over 10,000 of those cannot be accounted for. So again, they're probably, according to resources, inflating the number to make it appear worse than it is. But the majority of those 25,000, if there weren't that many, of the 35,000 that the Hamas claims, were not civilians. These were predominantly Hamas fighters. But they're including any deaths in Gaza, whether it's by natural causes, someone has a heart attack, they're including that in the death toll, blaming Israel. So the numbers are mixed, we're misinformed, but they're significantly less than they're reporting at 42.
Well, the ones that are 11, what's their name?
Hezbollah.
Hezbollah. How many of those are there?
Hezbollah has many thousands, Brother Schreiner. They have virtually taken over much of the fighting forces of Lebanon at the stage. Who knows, maybe 50,000 or more could be estimated.
Yeah, that's the one that's shooting the rockets.
They're shooting rockets to the north. They have an estimated, yes, according to Israel, over 150,000 potential rockets that could be launched into Israel. Some of them, obviously, stronger, better distance than the ones that have been launched. But still, there is that opportunity for them to come into Israel and causing great damage to major cities.
Well, they're continuing.
Israeli Defense Forces soldiers. They're using every opportunity they can to use acts of terrorism to harass Israel, to warrant a response from Israel to do something significant so the whole world can say Israel is over-responding and not using any restraint. In other words, she's the main Goliath. She's the oppressor. And that's what's feeding these colleges, that's what's feeding these cultural Marxists, is this idea of Israel being this oppressive, occupying power that continues to come against the Palestinians who are only trying to defend themselves and protect themselves.
Well, what would we do if Baker, which is right next door, was shooting missiles in Baton Rouge?
Well, Brother Sprague, I think we would immediately do everything we could to stop that from happening. And we would launch everything.
Yeah, we should.
And rightfully so, because you cannot subject the civilian population to this kind of lifestyle.
Those things are sort of random, though they don't have much target area.
Fortunately, Hamas has not had these strategic weapons that are able to cause significant damage. But once again, when they're launched, you don't know where it's going to go, so you immediately have to run to the bomb shelters. But look what Iran did. If it wasn't for the defense systems that Israel has in place, David Sling and these other means of protection, they would have caused significant damage to Israel. The drones, along with the ballistic missile systems that were launched, could cause significant death tolls. But fortunately, over 300 of them were stopped.
Yeah.
So Israel's in a precarious
position. They claim to have 100,000 of these rockets. I don't really believe they do.
Well, again, if Iran has been supplying Hezbollah, again, Hezbollah is a surrogate of the Iranians. They probably have some of those sophisticated rocket systems, but to launch those would create another significant war. Maybe they're just not ready for that at this time.
What is there? Over half of those rockets blew up in the air or dove into the ocean or whatever the case. They don't know what they're doing. Is that the situation?
Are you talking about the rockets being launched from the Hezbollah at the north?
No, I'm talking about from
Iran.
Yeah,
they launched several different types of rockets. Some of them were not significant, fell short of their targets. Others were knocked down by the country of Jordan, so they were instrumental in helping shoot them down. Likewise, though, there were many that did almost make it to Israel. Israeli jets were launched and did stop many of them in air from landing in locations.
And most of them were shot down by Israeli fighter planes.
That's correct. But if some of those would have got through, Brother Strider, they could have caused great civilian population damage as well as damage to properties.
All right. Any more questions or statements before we change the subject? Okay, Dave, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10.
Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord.
Be continuously, which one does by constant faith in the cross.
And in the power of his might.
His power is at our disposal. The source is the Holy Spirit, but the means is the cross. Now, we're talking here about, you might even say, a military action. And we are to expect the enemy to come against us to try to discourage us or destroy us or whatever the case may be. Spiritual warfare is what we're talking about here. And he said, be strong in the power of his might. Not our might, but his might. And that's speaking of the Holy Spirit.
That's right. Yes. Twice in the book of Ephesians already, Paul, in both prayers, there's two that are featured really in chapter 1 and in chapter 3. Paul's emphasis at the end of both of those prayers is power. Power of the Holy Spirit. But he would say it this way in chapter 1. He would say that we would come to know the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe. Secondly, he would say in chapter 3, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you could ask or think, according to the power that works in us. And in both cases, as is Paul's motif in the New Testament, he references power, but it's in the life of the believer salvation. It's the power that is given upon salvation, and it is available to every single child of God who is under the new covenant.
It's available, but not as we think. We think you just automatically function. If the Holy Spirit automatically functioned, there would never be a failure on the part of any Christian. He would just step in and take over, take control. But if you notice, he didn't do that.
Well, and that's going to be his exhortation here. If it was automatic, why would he have to say this finally, my brethren? Be strong. Being strengthened is literally what he's saying. So there's a choice we make, is what you're saying. We've got to put on the whole armor.
Well, see, Satan's effort is to try to get us to sin. And that'll weaken the child of God more than anything else. But it's for that believer to sin. I know I remember scores of letters in the past sent to us. Brother Swaggart, I love the Lord. And I'm doing all I can to live for him, but why won't the Holy Spirit help me? I'm spirit-filled, but he won't help me. And in a sense, they were right and they were wrong at the same time. The problem is sin, when you get down to the bottom line, it's sin. Satan wants to get us to fail, to sin, to commit iniquity. That'll weaken the child of God more than anything else. And he does that by his own subtle ways. But if the child of God doesn't know God's way, and I'll say what that way is in a moment, Satan will succeed.
Correct. One of the ways they fail to know it is this word power. It gets so balled up, Brother Swagger. We think because we speak in tongues and it's been taught this way for so long, that gives us access to this power. And I'm trying to emphasize that it's in Paul's writings. He takes the believer back to the born again experience. He takes us back to salvation and says this power is available upon believing, to us who believe. And so Paul, as he comes in and teaches on the Holy Spirit, he very rarely even mentions the Pentecostal experience of speaking in tongues when it concerns the Holy Spirit's work in our lives. I'm not saying he doesn't teach on it, he does. But his main emphasis is the power that's available upon being placed in Christ. And if we don't come to see that, we will think that if I have a Pentecostal experience, if I speak in tongues, that's what grants me this power.
Not necessarily.
But it's not the means of that power, because Paul again has already laid that.
Jesus atoned for all sin
at the cross.
And he atoned for all sin, period.
Pentecostal church is going to have... The Pentecostal church as a whole has put out the banner of Pentecost and defending Pentecost, and we're going to be Pentecostal, and gotten away from the cross, which is the right object of faith, which is the way that we have victory and we have this power, is because of the cross, not because of the power of Pentecost. I believe in the power of Pentecost. I'm Pentecostal. I've been baptized in the Holy Spirit since I was 7 years old.
That power is not just automatic.
It's not just automatic. I wanted to read, if I can, 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 6. Starts off, it says, and David was greatly distressed. At the end of the verses, but David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. And in your notes, he said the Hebrew says literally, he strengthened himself in Jehovah. So this is being strong in his might. He strengthened himself and he turned to the Lord, because the Lord was the only one that could help. It's the same presently. However, the modern church seems to turn to everything except the Lord. And I would say everything except the cross, everything except where the source of power is. So if we are looking Pentecostal experience that our baptism in the Holy Spirit is where we're going to have our power, it won't work. If we're looking in our communion, we're looking in our water baptism, we're looking in our church attendance, we're looking at our tithing, those things are not going to give us this power that Joseph's talking about.
It's our faith has to be not necessarily in the Holy Spirit, even though he's the one who carries out the work, but our faith is in Christ, what Christ did at the cross for us. He atoned for all sin, and the believer must ever understand that and place his faith accordingly. And the Holy Spirit demands that. And he places his faith in Christ and what Christ did at the cross. The Holy Spirit then, because Jesus has been given his just due, the Holy Spirit will begin to work on our behalf and to give us victory over the world, the flesh, the devil, whatever is needed. That's where the power is. I'm sorry.
Yes, sir. I just wanted to bring this up, that Paul actually, he confirms what you all are saying by the first statement there. When he says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. In the Lord means in Christ Jesus, which always points to Calvary.
Right.
So that's the key to receiving and walking in the power of his might, is we have to be in the Lord, in Christ Jesus, which means having our faith in the finished work of Calvary.
Yes.
So if we don't have that, then we don't experience that mighty power that Joseph talked about, the power of the Holy Spirit operating within our hearts and within our lives. So that's the key, in Christ Jesus.
You're exactly right. And if the believer, David said it a moment ago, if we think the Holy Spirit's going to step in and do the work, he's not going to do it.
Strength is in the Lord.
Right.
Samson is a perfect example. He had a gift. And he even made the statement, my strength is in my hair. But after that gift, his hair was cut, after his eyes were gouged out, he says in the end, Lord, strengthen me one more time. And in his death, he destroyed more Philistines than in his life. And so the strength of the church, we thought our strength is in the gift of the Holy Spirit. But our strength is in the Lord, the giver of the gift. And so when we, as the text says here, when we fail to see that the power is available to every believer, and the power is, we have access to it because we are in covenant with the Lord. Because of this better covenant based on better promises, we go back to what was said yesterday as we close the program. As God told Joshua, have not I commanded you, be strong and of a good courage.
Be not afraid.
Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with you whithersoever thou goest. Why? He was under covenant with Jehovah. He could expect that the strength of the Lord would be with him to defeat the Jebusites, the Amalekites, etc. And how much more so these spiritual foes that we are talking about here in this text, because of covenant with Christ. That's what Paul's trying to show us. Strengthen in the Lord. Be strong in Christ Jesus. So when you come across these spiritual adversaries, you too be strong and be strengthened in the Lord.
You've got the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus on your side if you will use it. And Jesus is the one who paid the price of Calvary's cross. And he atoned for all sin. And that means that we do not have to be overcome by any sin. Because he atoned for all sin, not just some, but all of them. And the Holy Spirit demands that we give him his just due. And as I believe Dr. David said it a moment ago, that it's the power of the Holy Spirit. But it comes because of what Jesus did in atoning for all sin.
You know, when we emphasize the Holy Spirit in that form and in that fashion, honestly, we're turning the baptism of the Holy Spirit into a work, because the focus is still on me. Well, now that I've been baptized, But we need to realize that the power to conquer sin has already been given. And again, it's back to salvation. Be strong in the Lord and the grief. That's passive. That's not something that I am doing. That's not something that I am earning. That's something that has been given to me. Paul would say in Romans chapter 8 that we are more than conquerors. Conquerors are the ones that go into battle and win the battle and then spoil the goods. Well, we are more than conquerors because we're not the ones conquering, but we're the ones that get the spoil of that battle and of that war.
But this is given to the person immediately upon being born again.
That's it. And there's nothing else that I have to do or earn, including the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm not saying don't be baptized in the Holy Spirit. That's not what we're saying. But when you emphasize it in a sense of I can be baptized in the Holy Spirit to win victory over sin or to win victory over the wiles of the devil, as Ephesians 6 will say here in a moment, that is not what this is talking about. The power has already been given to us. The power that raised Christ from the dead lives inside of us already.
I am strong in the Lord only as my faith is in Christ.
That's what has taken me so long to learn in my life, because I thought the strengthening of the Lord, being strong in the Lord, was me doing things. Instead of resting in what Jesus did at Calvary, it was working. And it was, I'm going to strengthen myself. I'm going to be strong in the Lord. And I'm going to read more of the Word. And I'm going to pray more. And I'm going to fast more. And I'm going to do all of these things. Because that was the MO of how I was brought up by well-meaning people who thought, we're going to live a life of holiness. We're going to strive for holiness. But they didn't understand the concept of resting in the finished work of the cross. It was working, and the idea of sanctification being progressive, that we weren't fully sanctified, but we were progressively being sanctified little by little, but we are fully sanctified. We're just learning how to live out that sanctification. We're learning how to live out what's already begun. So for me, worst of the clean minds is previous teaching, having to unlearn what you've been taught, being a part of Pentecostal holiness, kind of, which is, again, I'm not downplaying or mocking, because people were trying to serve God, they were trying to, their motives were right, but they didn't understand how to do it. They didn't understand how to go from working to resting. That just, I'm going to strengthen myself in the power of His might. That means I'm going to dive in and do all I can. And at the end of the day, people find themselves frustrated because they're like, Lord, I'm praying this many hours a day. I'm reading the Bible. I'm fasting. I'm doing so much, and I still can't stop with this sin that's besetting me, this thing that's so ingrained in my life. I still can't get victory over it. And that's where so many people are. And that's why this message is so important, is to stop working and start resting. Resting in what Jesus did. Understanding what He did. And when you do, it's like, you had a couple weeks ago, last week, you said, do you guys pray every night or ask the Lord to forgive you of your sins every day? To be honest with you, I said, I do. But I still got ingrained in me this idea of, the rapture's going to take place and I've got to be ready. Or I've still got this amount of, that old kind of thinking. And I promise you,
it's good.
Some of that, and that's good. And it's good, and it was good as a kid and a teenager, because my fear and reverence and respect of God kept me out of a lot of things, but it still didn't ultimately keep me from sinning, and it didn't keep me from understanding the grace of God. I didn't see God as this loving Father. I saw God for a time in my life as someone who was sitting on the throne ready to just thump me on the head for anything that I did. I didn't have a good picture.
Well, we're taught our Father. We're taught in the Word of God that our faith is to be in Christ and what He's done for us at the cross. Instead, though, we're taught what Jesus got to say, that if we do certain things more and more and more and more, then we'll have victory. And what makes it critical is every Christian ought to have a prayer life. But you can't pray your way through the victory. You really can't. And every Christian ought to fast at times, but you can fast until they pull you through a keyhole. And so, if you're not going to get victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil, and if you stop and think about it a moment, that's bypassing what Jesus Christ did at the cross, the terrible price that he paid. We're going around that, and we're forming our own calendar.
We form our own system of works. We say, well, I'm not under the law, I didn't do works. And then you say, well, I'm not Catholic, I don't perform all these sacraments of works. But then in Pentecostalism, we formed our own works, and we formed our own laws, and we formed our own things.
Yeah, right.
Galatians 3 and 3.
Our last name is Moses.
Well, that was it. That's where I was. Galatians 3 and 3, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? I mean, that verse in particular jumped out at me one day to really make me try to understand this. They put on the board, are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh?
And Satan doesn't care how much we do all of these things, because he knows it's not going to be helpful.
Yeah, and then if we focus on these works that you said are part of these disciplines that are part of every Christian's life, if we focus on those things, a lot of people also focus on experiences. So if we go to this revival, and I feel the presence of God, and I go to this revival, and I go to this conference.
Especially if they lay hands on me and I fall out.
Services in my life. I've had men of God that have prayed for me and laid hands on me, and I've fallen out under the power of God, and God has done a deep work in my life. But after the revival, after the campaigning is over, I have to learn how to live Monday morning, going to work, living out my life in this world for Jesus. And so we can't live from revival to revival to revival. We can't live from these experiences.
We shouldn't have to.
We shouldn't. I thought about this a lot. What does it mean to be revived, to have revival? To be revived means something was dead, and you are reviving. But shouldn't we have a point where we are solidly walking in the Spirit? We're solidly walking with the Lord, but we don't have to seek after these experiences, which camp meetings, revivals, by all means, please have them, go to them, get fed, have the great worship, have the great prayer time. These are blessings from the Lord, but that's not how we live out our life day to day. We have to learn how to live up the maintenance of our Christian walk, and that's why I think the message of the cross is so important, because it shows us after the revival is over, we've got to get up, we've got to go to work, we've got to go to school, we've got to live life, and we're not going to just constantly be in a setting where we're worshiping God with people and listening to preachers.
We've got to our work as believers is to believe. That's what our work is, to believe. Remember, the disciples came to Jesus.
To believe in the right thing.
Right, exactly. To believe in the finished work of Calvary. The disciples came to Jesus and said, what must we do to do the works of God? And Jesus' reply to them was to believe on him whom he has sent, whom the Father has sent. So basically Jesus was saying, this is the work of God, for you to believe on me. That was believing. That's our work. That's our responsibility. Everything else flows out of that.
He paid a terrible price for what we have. A terrible price. And for us to go install something else, it's an insult to the Lord. And how he puts up with us, I don't know.
What a grief. What a grief to the heart of God when we go another way.
It is.
But he, like you said, paid such great price.
which are given freely, given to you by God. And he said this, he said, if the believer doesn't know that these things are freely given to them, they're going to try in some way to win the victory, in this case over fallen angels, principalities, and powers, through their own means. And Paul lays it out very clearly in Colossians chapter 2, how the cross defeated, literally spoiled, rendered powerless, the efforts of Satan when he nailed our sins to the cross. And he made a show of them openly. And so because we're under our heavenly David, Christ, we have access to victory over demon spirits, powers of darkness, rulers of the darkness of this world. Again, it's a free gift. He's freely given us. John said it. We are more than conquerors. We're not just victors. We get to pick up the spoils in a victory that Christ has already won. And that's essentially what he's asking every child of God to do.
Tolerate us trying to do ourselves what only he can do.
close.
Excuse me, John, we did not really know what he had already done. I think that's a problem.
Well, I'm not saying it was done intentionally. It was done mostly of ignorance. But it concentrated on what we do and the idea that we're strengthened in his might, that we now have the power to do these things. That's not what's the word Kratos there is, the idea of power here. It's not dunamis. It's power that's, and we're endued with that power in his might. But the only way we can recognize that is to go back and look what he did for us. It's not our battle, it was his battle. And the battle we face today, the weapons of our warfare, are not carnal, but mighty through God, deploying down strongholds. So it's not our, what we can do, and that's the whole message today. What can we do? So we look to different works, we look at different programs, and now we're looking to the worldly things and psychology to help us navigate through these. This is spiritual warfare we're talking about. It's real. We are fighting against the enemy who's trying to steal our salvation, to steal the truth from us, to destroy us, and to take our souls. He is out for business. And the only defense we have is to be understanding that we were united in Christ, buried with him by baptism, the death, raised with him to newness of life, that new source of living, the Holy Spirit, is now available to us. And he's the one who destroyed on our behalf these powers that are working against us.
Yeah.
And if we rest in that through faith, and I'm just repeating in a succinctual way of all we've already said, clothed in the garment of this, then we'll better understand also what was talked about back in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 17, which Paul, the next verse, will be virtually quoting, that we're now have his righteousness. It's not ours. How do we get his righteousness? Not by any works of righteousness.
I'm going to pray so much. I'm going to fast so much. I'm going to witness so much. I'm going to give so much. Won't work.
That's what we know, though.
Yeah.
That doesn't earn righteousness nor maintain it. We have it imputed to us by what Christ did at the cross. How did we receive that righteousness? By faith. How do we walk in that righteousness? By faith.
We think that will make us strong to do the things that I mentioned. And don't misunderstand, every Christian should have a prayer life. But it should be for the right reason. It's not that this is going to make me strong. It really isn't. The faith in Christ and what Christ did at the cross will make me strong. And that only. And this is what the Holy Spirit is pushing us to do, to place our faith accordingly. And if, when we do these other things, and you think I'm speaking against them, I'm not. Every Christian needs a prayer life, and so forth. But for the right reason, for the right purpose.
And whenever we have the proper object of faith, it's actually going to cause us to pray a little bit more, because now I don't pray so that I can get power and out of desperation. I pray from a heart of thanksgiving because I realize God has already given me the power to overcome. And because of that, now my prayer has shifted from a focus on me. God, you have to help me. You have to give me the power. Now it's God, thank you, because you have already given me.
In this spiritual warfare, the devil has no problem in you. He'll find us in the day of the week.
And you know, I think it's Peter that says that the devil is our adversary.
Yeah.
He's after our soul. He's not the Lord's adversary. He's not God's adversary. Jesus has already defeated him. Death fell in the grave. He's our adversary, and he is a roaring lion seeking who he can devour, and he loves it whenever the focus is on us, our prayer life, or our experiences. But if our focus is on Christ and what he's done, he doesn't stand a chance.
In Psalm 37:7, it says, rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not yourself because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked devices to pass. And in your notes, he said, in verses 3 through 7, we have the four keys to a victorious life: trust, believe, commit, and rest. And I thought that was such a powerful way that you put there. Four keys to victory: trust, delight, commit, and rest. That's what so many people need to grab a hold of. Trusting in the things.
finish the work of Calvary, what Jesus did at the cross, delighting in the finished work, having a cross-centered life means you delight in the Lord, like you said, in prayer. As a being cross-centered, you're giving praise and glory in your prayer time, delight. Committing yourself is not committing yourself to do a bunch of works, but to keep your focus and your perspective on the cross, and then to rest in what He's done, and to know that God has you, that you're secure. You're secure because of your proper opportunity. You're secure because you have committed your trusting in Him. So you can have all of these things that are outlined in verses 3 through 7 in Psalm, resting in the Lord, fretting not, prospering. Even when wicked people bring devices to pass, even when attacks come against you, how many people need to learn the concept of fret not? How many people live in anxiety? How many people live in depression? How many people worry because they don't trust, delight, commit, and rest, and rest in what Jesus did at Calvary?
It ends in rest.
It ends in rest, and that's where people like me had to come to, and that's where a lot of religious people have to come to.
Oh, Lord, yes,
that is.
But for some, Brother Sorry, going back to the question of why is this not automatic? The statement in Colossians is He spoiled principalities and powers. We know that at Calvary, when He nailed the law to the cross, with the debt that was hanging over our head, he stripped Satan of his legal authority over mankind. And we know that He spoiled, took away their authority. But why are we still, quote, wrestling? Because, as you said earlier, it's not automatic. If it were so, there'd never be another Christian who would sin. If the Spirit's power and strength came automatically because we're simply in Christ, and I take what you said seriously, because there is a choice in the matter of what I'm going to trust in, and a daily choice. That's what Christ said. He said, deny yourself daily, take up the cross, and follow me. If you do not do this, you cannot be my disciple. But the thought is, if they're spoiled, why am I still having to wrestle with principalities and powers? And obviously, I don't have a perfect answer, but I do know God is a perfect parallel with the children of Israel going into the land. You made the statement in your book, The World, the Flesh, and the Devil, incidentally, which everybody should buy in. You mirrored the chapter, I believe it's Exodus 12 through 15, maybe 15 through 17, but here nor there, you said this in that book. You said, before they walked into the land, God had already given the land to His people. They had to believe that he had already given it to them, and expect as they went up to take the land, as Caleb and Joshua are famed for saying, we are able to go up and take the country. Where did that come from? They had to believe that God had already destined for them to live in victory and to take the land. It was theirs. They had to know that. But there was also a battle. There was a wrestling. There was an exhibition of faith, trust. And so
there has to be always.
And God will allow principalities and powers to oppose us for the purpose of strengthening our hands, to teach our hands to war, as David said. It's spiritual warfare. It's resisting the believer. And we wrestle is in the present tense. It's a fact, Jack. We are in a battle. It's happening ongoing, consistently. So those strategies of Satan to try to get us away from our power source, to try to get us to operate in the flesh, it's a very real battle, and it's ongoing. So again, it's not automatic, as you said. I agree 100%.
There is such a difference now in my own heart and life of what used to be and what is now. And I'm sure I have a long ways to go yet. I'm positive of that. But what little piece of war has taken me. God's joy and spent the one for the Lord. And the true Christian experience is not fighting the devil and getting wrecked. That's not the real experience. It is the experience of far too many of us, but it's not God's way. And Satan is scared to death of the cross. He trembles at the name of Jesus. And he can't be a joy unspeakable and full of glory.
Brother Swagger, it's really unbelief that keeps us from entering into that promise. Going back to what Joseph said, that you
think it is, David, or you think it's ignorance?
I think it's unbelief. Unbelief is that you are not willing to surrender to what God has given. And that's an aspect of belief that many Christians don't understand, that by surrender. So the children of Israel could not enter in because of unbelief. And in the same way, we as New Covenant believers, truly born again, baptized by the Holy Spirit, we don't enter into the victory that is in Christ because we won't surrender to what God has given.
Right along with what you just said, when the Lord first started opening up this great word to me, and like I said, I have a long ways to go yet, but I thought if our good assemblies of God and Church of God, whatever the case, if they just do this, their thinking would be different. And I thought it was just ignorance, but I found out it was not. It was unbelief. We just don't believe what you're talking about.
Not willing to give themselves over to it. Not willing to surrender to it.
Yeah, right. And that's really the, you were right. That's the real problem.
You taking that same story as Joshua and Caleb are standing before Israel saying, we are well able, these giants are bred for us, let's go take the country. They scream out, let's stone them, let's get a new leader and go back to Egypt, to go back to slavery, to go back to
what?
I mean, they're on the cusp of having everything that God has given them. And they scream, let's destroy the believers, those that don't know God's way and God's promise, and let's go back to the thing that destroyed us. I mean, that's us.
That's Jonah saying, Lord, let me go back into the whale.
Exactly. And it's the same thing that we see today, and it's people that will hear this message of Jesus Christ being crucified, but say, that can't be it. There's got to be more. Let's stone the messenger spiritually not literally stone him, but let's take him out. Let's destroy his character because we just don't agree with what they're saying. And let's go back into the way that has never worked.
Yeah, never worked is right. We've run out of time as well. And let me encourage you, please, to tell others about the program, the network. As many of you do, and we're so grateful for that. We appreciate it very, very much. And thank you for having been with us today. This is going to be the next few days of study. It's going to be interesting. And I hope you won't miss it. I hope you'll be with us because what Paul gives us here is phenomenal.